So that said, Jen, I just want to say I'm really liking our sermon series, mm-hmm. you know, Empty Tomb.
Yeah.
So again, a lot of people have approached us, texted us, and talked to us, you know, saying that they're having a deeper understanding and application and you know, revelation regarding the series,
mm-hmm.
the significance and the meaning of the empty tomb.
Yes.
That means Jesus' resurrection. When we talk about empty tomb,
mm-hmm.
we're talking about Jesus' resurrection. Sorry, you know, and again, from the very beginning, our goal for this one, Jen, is to give a sound and a tangible comprehension of the significance and the far-reaching implication of Jesus's resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
That's the whole purpose. That's why we wanted to start this. That's why we start this series. And again, we're talking about 1 Corinthians 15, 6 weeks, just camping on this. The longest theological explanation regarding Jesus' resurrection,
mm-hmm.
and the meaning of that. Again, the whole purpose of this is not just to highlight the historical facts, because what I realized, Jen, is this: as believers, we already know that Jesus rose from the grave.
Mm-hmm.
There's historical facts. Some people might doubt that, but most believer, and if you're a believer, I hope you believe that indeed he resurrected from the grave.
Mm-hmm.
But yet the question has always been, the most important question is, what is the significance of that?
Mm-hmm.
And also the meaning of that. Meaning and significance and the implication of that in our walk with the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And again, in our walk with God, in our present walk, and also in our future. And we're going to talk about that future life as a believer. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's very important, because again, when we talk about future, and like what I have mentioned last Sunday, we're talking about the eschatological implication of the empty tomb. And again, a huge word. Eschatology is the word. And but before that, Jen, any comment on that about the series? I know I'm just going ahead now, and just I could see that you just wanted to go ahead.
Well, I want to jump in and say, you know, the series is it's more than what we expected it to
yes.
be. You know, it's as if like, okay, yeah, I understand that Jesus resurrected, that's okay.
Yeah.
You know, we have
we say
a
that.
We say that,
we
have an
that.
Understanding of that. But then I think, like what you said, you know, the implication of that in our walk with God, in our lives today, in our perspective,
yeah.
has really, you know, opened up a lot of thought-provoking questions,
mm-hmm.
things that you have to really like ponder on and think about. And I think it has nailed and hammered to us the importance of that the empty tomb or the resurrection of Jesus in the gospel, because normally it's just at the tail end,
yeah.
and he rose on the third day, he rose from
the
dead. That's it.
Okay, so.
But you know, the Jesus' birth, his suffering, is, you know, we all like, you know, dived into that. We know that, we tell stories about that, but then the resurrection of Jesus is just like a one thing at the end, and then that's it. You know, after 3 days, he rose from the dead, and
yeah.
then that's it.
Yeah.
But it has, without that, all the previous things, Jesus's birth, his life, and his death, has no meaning if he did not resurrect.
And also has no significance. Because again, that is the most important portion.
That's
because
right.
again, that's the culmination of the promise,
mm-hmm.
the evidence mm-hmm. of really if he is saying the truth
about
or if
he claims to be,
right?
Yes.
That's what we talked about in week one.
Yeah.
Is either a liar, a lunatic, or Lord, according
yes.
to C.S. Lewis, and also Watchman Nee in his book. So, you know, talking about that. What a great claim from Jesus. Either he is really lying to us, a liar, lunatic, who's a madman, or really he is Lord. And again, we have established that as Paul has written, you know, that he is indeed Lord.
Yes.
Because he provided evidence to us. Now we look at a little bit this, Jen, and we're
mm-hmm.
talking about the eschatological implication. Again, don't get scared with the word eschatology.
Mm-hmm.
And let me put that on the screen for us. I know some of us are like, you're tuning out. Eschatology, what's that? No, it's not the one in the Philippines when you...
What's that?
The green circle that you light up, it's katol. You know, it's
Catholic.
So to drive away all the mosquitoes is not that. So eschatology is simply the study of what the Bible says is going to happen in the end times.
Mm.
So it is what it is. It's the study of what the Bible says. And again, it's not something that we made up. We're still going back to the Word. We're still going back to the Bible. And what the Bible says that's going to happen in the end times. So again, it's interesting about the Bible because again, the Bible gives us also a glimpse of the future. So it's not just the present. Yes, it's interesting about our walk with the Lord that we look at the past because looking at what Christ has done, and then you live that what he has done in the present, but also it asks you to look forward as well in the future because how the end will be. I like that, to be honest with you. You know, I like the whole premise of that. I look at the past of what Jesus Christ has done, you know, live that in the present, you know, applying that in my life today, but also looking at the future. So it seems like for me, Jen, especially now that I'm glad that people are tuning in, knowing that it's the NBA playoff and you are still here, praise God. And I'm just looking for some of the men to tune in because again, it's NBA playoff. It's like, you know, when you are in a competition and when you are in a, like for example, the playoff, that the Bible already wrote who's gonna win at the end. It's like everybody was saying, you know, it's common among men who loves NBA that some people are saying there's conspiracy theory that there is a script already written who's going to win the championship. Of course, it's not. And I think that's what it is, isn't it? And I think for us, it's a good thing because it's not rigged. It's just because the Bible already given to us the script and who's going to win at the end. And it's so interesting because already God, you know, God already laid out who's going to win. But yet, some people still doubt. Some people still don't believe. And still, some people still choose not to be with the winning team. And, you know, I don't know. For some reason, maybe we just wanted to be sure. All right. And Dr. Brown, welcome. Thank you for joining us this evening as well. So the study what the Bible says is going to happen in the end times deals with the doctrine of the last things, hence eschatology, esca being like last, eska, actually the Greek word esca is last, and ology is the study. So that's where it came from, especially the second coming of Christ. So the first coming came during Christmas, now there's going to be a second coming, and most of the eschatology is about that, the second coming of Jesus Christ, or the Greek word is parousia, or the appearing of Christ. Actually, it was mentioned here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So again, it is, again, not only that, it is the study of theology involved with death, judgment, and the final destiny of the soul and humankind. So the second coming of Jesus involved this, death, judgment, and the final destiny of mankind. So this is very important. So it is sad to say that most believers are either in the opposite extremes of the second coming. So one would be in the extreme of they don't really acknowledge the second coming, like clueless. I mean, like, I don't know what's going on, really, I don't know. And the other one would be either that or the super obsessed with the second coming. So we have those two, actually, the one that are actually clueless, and that's why this series is about that. When we were actually planning for this series, I felt like we need to have a theological understanding of really the resurrection, because it talks about the end times, and again, most of us are clueless about that. Just like what you mentioned a while ago, yes, he rose from the grave, and then we stopped from there. And then we have the other extreme of people are so much concerned and obsessed about the second, consume about it. That they are following all the lies about the dates and the time, and it's all about the rapture, and they are living in the future that they forget to live here right now in the present. So that's the danger here. And that's why this series is for us to be able to come into this middle ground of really understanding what it is, the significance and the meaning of that. And also it gives us hope for the future. And I love that because, again, faith and hope, faith that, you know, trusting in what Christ has done as I look back, hope for the future, because I know it gives me hope that though things are not what it looks like and what it's supposed to be, my hope is that because God already written the script, I know who's going to win at the end. See, I may not feel like it. I may not see it now. But it doesn't, you know, it doesn't matter. So I'm not supposed to be ruled by my emotion. I have to put my faith in the Word of God. Mm-hmm. Jen?
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. Well, with all the wars and the... Remember the wars, and then even with the pandemic that had happened and all of that, I think people just got so, yeah, consumed about thinking about, is the end here and now? Is, you know, and they're so concerned about, you know, what's going to happen that mm-hmm. they forget that there is a purpose why they are still here.
Exactly.
Earth, and, you know, and they're just thinking about that day.
Exactly.
But they forgot that there's a life that God has given them now, and there's a purpose and a reason why they are alive.
And you're living and breathing, and it always comes to the mission that God had given us.
Yes.
And again, we don't know the dates, but the Bible is very clear about the signs mm-hmm. that has been given to us.
Mm-hmm.
Some of those, I might talk about that this coming, because again, we're going to dive deeper into this. But last Sunday, here's what we said,
mm-hmm.
talking about the connection of the empty tomb to our eternal destiny. Here's the one statement for last Sunday, if you didn't attend, is that Jesus' resurrection is the guarantee of our eternal destiny.
Mm-hmm.
It is a guarantee of our resurrection someday, because we will be resurrected with Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
It's a guarantee that he will return, actually.
Yeah.
That's why he rose from the grave, he ascended to heaven, and one day he will come back.
Yeah.
It's a guarantee. Because again, if he didn't rise from the grave, then no one's going to return because he's still in the grave.
Yeah.
So,
right.
So that is that declaration that really he is alive when he comes the second time.
Mm-hmm.
And again, it will bring resolution to all things. And in week 4 and 5, we will go deeper to that, you know, and theologically, logical, practical argument that Paul presented. And the significance of the empty tomb. We'll talk about two questions actually in the 4 and 5. Number one is that how the dead are raised. And I think in the second, what body are we going to be having when we are resurrected from the grave?
Mm-hmm.
So 4 is what body, and I'm going to talk about that
mm-hmm.
this coming Sunday. So it's going to be interesting. Trust me, this is going to be one of those very interesting, very encouraging moments, understanding really the importance of the resurrection of Jesus Christ or the empty tomb. So that said, Jen, we're going to continue, just like what I mentioned. So that said, tonight we will continue where we left off,
mm-hmm.
and we're going to start again. I said last Sunday, if you're with us, that I said I'm going to explain the latter part of the text, and that's exactly what I'm going to do this Wednesday. So let's start again here. Let's continue. 1 Corinthians 15. 26 and 27. And while I'm reading this and I'm talking and while discussing this, I want to encourage you. What was your, you know, tell us, share it to us, share in the comment section. I mean, you're kind of like your revelation, your understanding, your new understanding. It's kind of like, wow, this is something that I didn't realize, you know, talking about Jesus' resurrection or the empty tomb. You could write it here in our comment section and so that I could read that, and then we could have some little interaction here.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Jen, let's go read 1 Corinthians 15. I want you to read that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, 26 to 28.
Yes.
The last enemy that will be destroyed is death. The scripture says that God has put everything under his control. Psalm 8, verse 6, it says that everything has been put under him, but it is clear that this does not include God himself. That's because God put everything under Christ. Verse 28, when he has done that, the Son also will be under God's rule. God put everything under the Son, S-O-N. In that way, God will be all in all.
Amen. And what a continuation from the Apostle Paul. And again, talking about the theological explanation, just like what I've said, he started with some historical evidence of the resurrection, followed by a logical argument, and now he's making a theological argument. Last Sunday, we talked about this. The eschatological implication of this, the end times. And one of that is that he starts with, let's start with verse 26, the last enemy will be destroyed is death.
Mm-hmm.
And again, when he comes, according to what we read last Sunday, remember, it says here that it's going to be in order, right? Remember
mm-hmm.
that? And then before, then the end will come. So first, Christ is resurrected, the first fruit, and then those who belong to him, and then the end will come. And then he narrates to us how this ending is going to be. So in these three verses, actually, 26, 27, and 28, this is quite a good news. You know why? Because in these verses, in a very general description, actually, Paul describes how the end will be.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are watching a movie, Paul already gave you the highlight. So that means there's no more surprise. And I think the only surprise is that, of course, seeing that. So it's like reading the script. But the only difference is that the script and the movie is quite different. I don't know. I didn't work in the movie industry, but, you know, but watching this, you know, reading the script and seeing it in the movie is quite different. And I think this is what's happening here. So we are reading the script, but in the future and how the end will be, that's, it's like watching a movie more than that, because we're going to see exactly what's going to happen here. So here's what it is. These verses describe to us how the end will be. And to maybe you're asking, well, Pastor, why is this important? And again, it's connected again to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And according to the Apostle Paul, because he rose from the grave, he ascended to heaven, and now he's coming back again. And then after that, then the end will come. And how is the end? Will, how does the end, or the end will unfold? Here's what Paul says. All right? And here's 2 points here. And I think this will encourage you very much as far as this. And I'm going to explain that in a practical application in our walk with the Lord. Here's the first one. Jesus will bring everything under his reign. Jesus will bring everything under his reign. Jesus will bring, open, close, everything, because according to this, actually what you're reading here is the New International Reader's Version. I think I was looking at different translation. This is the simplest way for us to understand what was going on in the text. Because again, the ESV is quite a little, you know, if you're not, you might get lost when you read 27 to 28. So it says here, in due time, what we're reading here, the last enemy that will be destroyed is death. You know what death is? Eternal separation from God. You know how death started. Death started when Adam and Eve, especially Adam, you know, disobeyed God. And after that, of course, in Genesis chapter 3 is the bad news. And now we come to the good news, which is the good message, which is what Christ has done. And the good news, part of the good news, is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So it says here, scripture says that God has put everything under his control. I like the New International Version because it even puts the psalm where it is found. So Paul was quoting Psalm 8 verse 6 here. And then he says, it says that everything has been put under him. I like that. It means everything. So that means, listen to me now. If you're a believer here today, you're going through some challenges. You see what's going on around us. You see it seems like the enemy is winning. It seems like you look at California and all the wickedness that is going on in this state. You don't have to go far, and all over the world and everything that is happening around us. Here's what it is. Jesus will reign over all creation. That means, what do you mean? Completing his task of restoring what was lost. So, again, yes, he died on the cross. Yes, he ascended to heaven. But yet, the task is not yet complete. Already, but not yet. Remember, I mentioned that last Sunday. Already, because he defeated death, but we could still see it. But though, you know, it's a physical death for us. But, of course, our spirit goes to God, and then our body will be resurrected someday. But here's what it is. So, what we were saying here is this, that everything has been put under him. So, that means he, what? Completing his task. When he returned, he will complete the task, because he would restore everything as it is from the Garden of Eden, because that's what it is. So what was lost in the garden, now it is gonna be brought back to what it is to be. So interesting, because again, even when I was preaching Jesus, when he was, you know, praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, for me that is a picture of two gardens. The two gardens were in Adam, in the Garden of Eden, disobeyed God. He did his will, not God's will. And Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, what was Jesus' prayer? Not my will, but your will be done. For me, those are the two pictures of the garden. And it's because of Jesus' obedience. And Jesus' obedience and living a sinless life. Now, he resurrected from the grave. And now he's coming back to restore everything, restoring what was lost. And the question is, what was lost in the garden? Our relationship with God. You know, our relationship with the Lord. So man's relationship with God is lost. And Jesus came to restore that. Second is that creation has been hurt as well. Again, the ground was cursed. And everything will be restored again. That's why there's a promise in the Bible. When you read the Revelation, there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm going to explain that a little bit more, or this coming week, you know, as we talked about. So that means God, Jesus, when he returns, he's going to restore everything that was lost. And also he will humble all his enemies under his feet. That's why when you read the second half of that, everything has been put under him or subjected, according to, let's read here, ESB, for God has put all things in subjection under his feet. So they're using a metaphor here, a subjection under your feet. That means everything will be humbled. Interesting. So that means all authorities, all power, or all rulership that didn't acknowledge who Christ is and the lordship of Christ, it may seem that they're getting away with that, but in due time, when he returns, everybody will declare that he is the Lord of lords and also he's the King of kings. So the question here, Jen, is that either you declare it now or you declare it in the future when it's too late, but everybody will be subject, will be under his reign. Jesus Christ will reign. He won. Amen. Mm-hmm. He won the victory for us. Jesus is the victor. Mm-hmm. Okay. So that means I want to be part of the winning team. And to be honest with you, Jesus is the winning team. Mm-hmm. Team Jesus. I want to be part of Team Jesus. Not Team Satan, not Team World, or Team Robert. Mm-hmm. Self. Either I acknowledge it now or in the future, people will still acknowledge that he is Lord, because everything, according to what we have read, has been put under him. Mm-hmm. Wow. Any comment on that, Jen?
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because, you know, people may choose not to believe this, but at the end of the day, when Jesus returns, everything will be known. Mm-hmm. He will be known as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. In other words, it's inescapable. We won't be able to escape him being Lord. And
yes.
I think that's the thing with us today. Because we don't see him physically,
yeah.
We don't feel him, right? You know, we think that he is not, things are not under him,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the pressing question that I was thinking about is that why would Jesus wait to return
the
second?
That is a good question.
So why not when he first ascended, when he first resurrected, why did he not complete the work? You know, immediately complete the work, but then he had to go up to heaven and
wait.
Mm-hmm. Wait. And then that's why we're still here.
Yeah.
Or we're still
that
waiting.
That's a great question.
Right? And so I think why did he have to wait? Why didn't he just finish and complete it? It's done.
That's a very good question. Mm-hmm. And why wait? And again, the waiting now is as we are waiting, because you have to go back to the mission.
Mm-hmm.
Go and make disciples of all nations,
mm-hmm.
baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you.
Mm-hmm.
Acts 1:8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you,
mm-hmm.
and you will be my witnesses.
Mm-hmm.
So all of the waiting is to give people,
mm-hmm.
mankind, you and I, a chance to acknowledge
That's
his
right.
lordship.
Mm-hmm.
That's why.
Yeah.
But there would come a point that grace will be gone.
I love it. So
mm-hmm.
I actually had an idea, but
yes.
I just, I love that you said that, because, you know, our God is really a gracious and compassionate God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because if he resurrected and then he chose to complete everything, most probably not a lot of people
mm-hmm.
will know him, right? Not a lot of people have acknowledged him as in fact, they crucified him on the cross.
Exactly.
And so nobody will be saved in a sense, you know. But I love that, God is giving us an opportunity now. Now is our opportunity. Now is the chance for us to receive that grace, to acknowledge that this is the time for us to make that decision,
yeah.
whether to acknowledge him as Lord in our lives or not.
while we live, because again, just like what we're saying, Jesus will bring everything under his right. We are gonna acknowledge, everyone will acknowledge him as Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Because as we have read here, everything has been put under him. That means subjected under his feet. That means we'll acknowledge his rulership.
Yes.
So here's what it is for me. That's why, what's the implication for this for us as a believer? Number one, that we should do the mission that God called us
yes.
to do. Because that's why the prolonging of his coming
mm-hmm.
is based on our either eagerness and laziness to proclaim the good news to others.
Yes.
Because what the Bible says is that everyone will be given a chance to hear this message, and then he will come.
Yeah.
So as we spread the gospel, then he will come. And that's why more and more, and what's another sign that we need to look up here? It was in the early years, it was impossible for us to be able to reach everyone,
mm-hmm.
but the disciples, the apostles, the missionaries went out and shared the gospel. But as we continue to see the progression of technology,
yeah.
there are more and more hearing the gospel.
That's right.
And the more and more the chance of Jesus coming back is near.
Yeah.
I just don't know. I don't know the date, to be honest. So yes. I'm glad to say. Let's read some few comments here.
Okay, great. Kevin says, to spread the word and give humans more time to believe.
Amen.
Yes. Joshua says, amen, in Matthew, and the gospel will be preached in all the world, then the end will come.
There we
That's
go.
Right.
That's what I'm saying. So now, as we see, people have the access now. People could hear, you know, could watch Facebook, Instagram, everything, Google, the word. Now everybody has a phone. Most.
Yes.
Then the world, the end will come.
Mm-hmm.
We are coming into that fruition closer
yeah.
and closer.
That's right.
And that's why, for me, I think it's just, again, I'm speaking in a sense of course, when we talked about our, now the implication is that, the second implication for me is that as a believer then, when we're going through difficulty, right? And sometimes we just say, God, can you just return? Okay. But we don't see the bigger picture, really. The bigger picture of God's plan. If we fail to see the bigger picture of God's plan, then here's what's going to happen. We're just going to live for the moment. We're just going to live for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not going to live to fulfill his mission.
That's right.
And that's quite dangerous. And it's why people that doesn't understand the eschatology, the end times,
mm-hmm.
and for me, are the people that just live for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They don't live for God's mission and for God's purposes.
That's right.
And I think it affects us, you know,
mm-hmm.
in the way we live as believers.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, Matthew 24:14, as you know, then the gospel will be preached.
Yes.
It will be preached into all nations.
The world, yeah.
And then it will be come. Then Jesus will come. And what is the good messages we talked about? The life, death, the ministry, the life, the ministry, death, and the resurrection.
Of Jesus.
That's what we're talking about here. The empty tomb. That's part. Because part of what we share is that not only that God saves them, but also the future of what we're talking about here. That Jesus Christ will reign.
Yeah.
He is. Okay, every aspect of creation will come under his dominion, establishing him as King Jesus, the ruler of the universe.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's not He-Man. He-Man, right? So that's my cartoons growing up as well. He-Man is the what? He-Man. They said, I am the power. I think it's what? Or Voltron, the defender of the universe.
Mm-hmm.
No. It's not He-Man, it's not Voltron, it's Jesus. Is the ruler of the universe. Amen? And that, either now. So the question now is this. Let me ask you this. The question is Jesus really king of your life?
Yeah.
Is this really Lord? Is his rulership and dominion is really evident in the way we live?
Mm-hmm.
Because if that is true, and you look at the reaction of the early believers, is that they were willing to let go of everything.
Mm-hmm.
To them to pursue what the purposes of God. And why? Because they understood how the end will end.
Mm-hmm.
The people that doesn't have the understanding of the end times usually are people that doesn't live for
yeah.
God's glory.
Yeah. Yeah. I just said, you know, think that, wow, when we preach the gospel, this is basic.
Yeah, this is a part, basic actually.
This is basic, and this is part, and this is very important for us to understand. This is basic in our belief as a in the gospel. If we say we believe in the gospel, this includes that everything will be under the reign of Jesus. And I love the two implications that actually you mentioned, and I hope you didn't miss it, because this is very, very important in a believer's life, that we make a choice right here, right now, whom we will serve as Lord.
Yeah.
You know, and if there are areas in our life that He is not Lord, then we have to choose. This is the time, this is the grace, this is where the grace of God is still available for us. You know, we have to make that choice. And then, go ahead. And then the second implication is that, you know, if we actually made our choice to make Him as our Lord, be under His rulership, then it means that we will follow His mission, because that's His mission, that we're following Him, therefore we follow His mission, which is we preach the gospel, we inch people closer to Jesus, we go and make disciples of all nations. I think that's
and let me just read here. Mm-hmm. You're dating yourself. I remember those. What's the context, Dr. Brown?
dating yourself, like the they would find out
that you're born. Yeah. Got you.
That's why she's like, LOL.
I know.
People know.
Yes.
Because you're talking about He-Man and...
Oh, yes. Now I know. I'm 53, so yeah. By the way.
So he just
thank
broadcast
you, Dr. Brown.
That,
he just broadcasts everything.
Yeah.
So, but... And that's why, Jen, when you... And again, this is a self-reflection now.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to use this and also looking at what's happening in the life of the apostles. And that's why the early Christians, haven't you noticed, they are not afraid to die?
Yes.
Because they understood who reigned. They understood that they're going to be resurrected with Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
They're not afraid to let go of anything, to pursue the mission that God gives, because they know what's the most important thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
And that's why when you look at your life today, the way you live, my two questions to you is this, two things. Number one is that the way you live today, are you really living under the Lordship of Jesus Christ?
Mm-hmm.
Do you really understand that? Because it affects really how you live. If you understand that at the end, He rules, He reigns.
Yeah.
And number two is this, that we are partnering with Him as God gives the world the grace,
mm-hmm.
is that also that we partner with what He's doing,
yeah.
to preach the gospel,
mm-hmm.
to the people.
Yes.
So that we hasten the coming of Jesus.
Yes.
That's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
You want Jesus to return? Preach the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
Then the end will come.
Mm-hmm.
So, or are we living for, you know, fighting with our for our own kingdom, just taking care of our own little kingdom or little comfortability, that we cannot even die for Jesus, for what He asked of us. Because again, if that's the case, then we don't understand that He reigns.
Mm-hmm.
We still don't understand that what Lordship is about.
Yeah.
Lordship is that He reigns,
mm-hmm.
and we are under Him. And He's a gracious, benevolent, loving, loving kindness,
mm-hmm.
you know, is one of the attributes of God. God, when He asks us, though, we have to understand this. He's still Lord.
Yes.
Jesus will bring everything under His reign. So either you're going to be part of the enemies of God,
mm-hmm.
or you're going to be those whom He would return for.
Mm-hmm.
And I love this in Revelation. Dr. Brown says, I want nothing more than to live for Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Yes.
And to do His will.
Yes.
Very important. Living for Jesus is doing His will.
That's
and
right.
doing His mission.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And look at this. And as we continue, Revelation chapter 11, verse 15. And here's what it says. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet. Talking about, again, the revelation. Again, another, you know, apocalyptic scripture here, talking about the future and what's going to happen. And there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of His Christ, and He shall reign forever and ever. Wow. There's going to be a loud voice. It's going to be announced. The kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord. That means he's going to win, ladies and gentlemen.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the day, God wins.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want you, but I want to be part of the winning team.
Yes.
When you play a game, you want to win.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it is. Go on. A lot of silent people today. I want to hear your comment on this. Share your thoughts. And we will read that. What realization are you having right now? So, and number two, we're going to continue. God's glory will reign supreme throughout the entire universe. Not only that Jesus will reign. Because at the end of that text, when you read that, let me just go back to that text in verse 27. And here's what it, but it is clear that does not include God himself. So Paul was kind of like logically saying to us, of course, when we, everything will be under his feet. God the Father is not going to be under Jesus here. Because again, there is no problem here as far as the Trinity is concerned. That's because God put everything under Christ. What we're saying here is the Trinitarian work of the redemption of mankind.
Mm-hmm.
So this is no, some anti-Trinitarian would use this as to say that, see, even Jesus is under the Father. No, they're equal in who they are.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? So let's read this from Andrew 10.
Mm-hmm. Andrew says, that's true. Sometimes I think about just myself. Lord, can you just come back now so I may not be experiencing any more world like pain, etc. And forgot the mission that Jesus gave us. It was my selfish ambition.
Yes, all of us really, if we're going to be honest, we have that selfish ambition.
Yeah.
That Lord, just return because I want to end this. I want to end my suffering. I want to end. But we have to go beyond that.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of praying, Lord, come back now, is that Lord, to for us not to focus on our pain and suffering, is that to continually do what God called us to do.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? Doing what God called us to do is not easy.
Mm-hmm.
But here's the thing. God's glory will reign supreme throughout the universe. Look at this in 1 Corinthians 15:28. When he has done that, then the Son will be under God's rule. God put everything under the Son. In that way, look at this, God will be all in all. So when death is destroyed and Jesus hands over the kingdom to the Father, then God will be all in all. I like this statement here. In NLT, New Living Translation says, as being utterly supreme over everything and everywhere. That's what it means. God will be all in all. That means utterly supreme over everything and everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So the question is, God in all, what does it mean? So here's what it is. The glory of God is the visible manifestation of his attributes and his character. What we're saying here is that the glory, God's glory, will reign supreme. So that means God's visible manifestation of his attributes and character. So when everything is under God's, as he submits that to the Father, as the Father, you know, honors Jesus for what he has done, then everything will, God will be all in all. So that means the glory of God, which is what we use, the Shekinah glory, the manifest presence of God, will be now, his attributes, his character, will be what? Everything in everywhere. So that means there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. So everything now will be declared that will be what? Belongs to God.
Mm-hmm.
Because death, Satan, sin is already been subdued. Okay? So everything belongs to God, for he made it and it goes back to him again. So what was stolen in Genesis chapter 3 is restored. That's why God will be all in all. Imagine when Adam and Eve was walking in the garden, and the scripture would say that God would walk with them because God is in all, in everything. That it's going to happen again. It cannot happen right now because, again, we are all going to die.
If he does,
if he does that.
If he walks with us.
Talking about the set apart series.
Yes.
You know, unholy and holy cannot exist on the same. But it doesn't mean that God is not here. He's omnipresent, one of his attributes, but his glory, quite different.
Mm-hmm.
That's why in Exodus chapter 33, let me present this to you. This is Moses, of course, praying to God. And here's his what he asked of God. And let's put that on the screen. 33:18, Moses said, please show me your glory.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I will make all my goodness pass. And this is God speaking to Moses now. And I will make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim before you my name, the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy in whom I will show mercy. So that means, because again, Jesus was, God was saying that to Moses, is because again, look at the statement on verse 20. He said, you cannot see my face, for man shall not see me and live. So because of that, so as you could see, God's glory will reign supreme throughout the entire universe. But sin has to be defeated. Death has to be defeated. The completion of that, all the enemies will be under the subjection or under the rulership of Jesus. And then everything will be restored. And now from, here's what I call man-centeredness, now will become God-centered again. Because right now, this is man-centered. Mm-hmm. Everything that we looked at here in this world will be God-centered again. Sometime in the future, every aspect of creation, every individual, every circumstance will rely solely on God once again. He will become the essence of everything to everyone. Mm-hmm. All right? Eternity will revolve around God, the origin, sustainer, and culmination of all creation. Once again, it goes back to God again. That's why he will be, God will be all in all. Wow. I can't wait for that day, to be honest. And again, either that's one of the greatest news you're going to receive, or the scariest news that you're going to receive.
Yeah. I remember we talked about the song, Show Me Your Glory.
Yeah.
And there was a praise and worship song.
From Third Day. Show me your glory.
I can't remember, but there was a song. It says, Show me your glory. And the song was basically praying what Moses said here. And then Robert asked me, do I really want to pray that prayer? Because if God shows up right now, you know, it he would really consume, his holiness will consume, you know, everything mm-hmm. around us that is unholy in a sense. And so I think what I get from here is that, remember, in this world there's a lot of evil, there's a lot of things, you know, that's happening, that's like we were saying, Lord Jesus, if you really are reigning, why is this
all
this
evil things happening
in this world? You know, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, I think those questions are going to be once and for all gone when, you know, Jesus comes and mm-hmm. he restores everything. And you know, everything is, what you call this, that God will be all in all, because everything will be under his rule. Everything will be, there's no more evil. There's no more sin. There's no more death. Everything is wholly set apart, you know, for him. And so we can actually be with him without being destroyed, because the thing that actually consumes us is the unholiness caused by sin. Mm-hmm. Therefore, because sin has been defeated, death has been defeated, therefore we can see God, see him in all his glory, like really
glory.
Manifest, see him.
Yeah.
It's no longer like a long distance kind of like, you know, see him in video
or
call.
Just
or
enough, or
just
it's
enough.
Really there, because you read the Revelation, we're going to be there seeing God.
Yes.
And live.
Yes, and live.
So, but now, as you could see, let's read some for your comments here. Thank you for the explanation. It's never been explained like that before. To God be the glory. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Praise. Praise God for that. And Joshua says, wow, the hope of glory. He said, that's why Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's why when you go back, again, this is what it is, right? In Exodus, now you look at John. It's not on the screen. John chapter 1,
mm-hmm.
verse 14. And the Word became flesh. Talking about Jesus. And the Word became flesh. 1:14. And dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting, right? Grace and truth.
And
glory. So why is it that we have seen Jesus that we have not died?
Mm-hmm.
Grace and truth.
Truth. Mm-hmm. Grace and truth.
And also him coming in.
Human flesh.
Human flesh. Incarnation. Because if not, if he came down here in his God form,
mm-hmm.
I mean, it is like Isaiah being in the presence of God, you know, take the call to atone for him, because again, no one stays in the presence of God and lived.
Yeah.
And no one stays in the presence of God and live forever.
Yeah.
But yet God says, I will show mercy. That means, he, you know, and again, we could interpret that in many things. But at the end of the day, here's what it is. What I'm saying is this, that at the end of the day, this is Jesus. The exact manifestation, the character, what we talked about, glory, right? The description, let me put that. The glory of God is a visible manifestation of his attributes and his character. That's glory. And John calls Jesus that. Why? He's the visible manifestation of God and also attributes and character. Everything that Jesus has done was to express who God is, because he is God. In the flesh.
Anjo says, thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Yes, that's a response that we want. JC says, when we go through challenge in our life, instead of Jesus Christ reigning in our lives, we tend to still choose and follow our flesh to reign in our own self.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right.
That's correct. And that's why this is very important. You could see, we're just talking about the empty tomb here. And now, eschatology is what we're talking about, right? The end times. And again, this doesn't have to be scary. When we talk about end times, this is not scary, and this is not complicated.
Yeah.
Are there things that we don't understand? Yes, because again, this coming Sunday, I'm going to talk about that. Because Paul talked about, on the fifth week, but on the fourth Sunday. Because it talks about the mystery and the victory. Actually, that's his title, the mystery of this resurrection. But enough, there's enough for us to which we could stand on. And what's that? God's glory will reign supreme. So at the end of the day, he is going to complete this. Amen? And once again, we will experience to be in the presence of God as he, everything was made for him and will be brought back to him again. Because he's the one who created everything.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, I hope you guys.
I hope you are encouraged hearing this.
Confused or
yes.
Not dizzy or anything like that. But this is basic, just like what I said, you know. And I love that we get the opportunity to talk about it in this way, not when it's controversial or when a lot of people tend to either blow it out of proportion. But it's just
or use it in a way as a weapon to scare people.
Yes,
and force. Decisions
from
people. I'm not going to do that because, again, we just have to understand. I'm giving you the text and we're reading the text.
Yeah, and the choice is up to us.
Mm-hmm.
It's up to us if we would believe, that Jesus, at the end of the day, is and will reign over all. Everything will be under him, under his rulership and reign, and that God's glory will reign supreme
when
he comes.
And what we see here in this world, you may not understand what's going, but it doesn't mean that he's
not
reigning.
Yes.
So that means when you reflect that over your life, so there's some challenges that you're facing, some injustice, some everything. At the end of the day, it's all going to come into fruition that everything will be exposed. Everything will be made right.
Yes.
So that's why that is our hope.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't get your justice here, you will get your justice when Jesus returns.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even if you're having some aches, sickness, all of those, guess what? Jesus, when he returns, everything will be restored to its original. It's like, let me close it this way. It's like, when you buy TVs or computers or phone, and then you have put a lot of things in there, and then you don't know what to do anymore. So restore to factory setting. Remember, there's a button. That's actually what's gonna happen when Jesus returns and completes everything. He's gonna restore it to the factory setting.
What it's supposed to be. Mm-hmm.
And only God can do that.
Yes.
You know why? Because the criteria is this. You have to live a sinless life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And none of us can.
Mm-hmm.
Because we are part of Adam. Remember the doctrine of federal headship?
Mm-hmm.
Our representative is Adam. And we failed. And now, Jesus Christ is the one who's going to represent us because we belong to him. Interesting. Amen.
Yeah.
So, amen. And also, I'm encouraged. Thank you. Thank
you,
Dr. Brown.
Yes. And I think that's the response that we want to get. It's not fear, but it's encouragement and hope.
Yes.
Like
hope.
Looking forward, to His reign, His rule, His coming. But yet, even though as you're looking forward, you're also looking at now and making that decision to make sure that He is really reigning and ruling in your life, mm-hmm. making that decision and fulfilling the mission that He has called us to do.
Yes.
While we all wait for His return, anticipate His return.
Yes.
Yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. And I hope that is encouraging to you guys.
Yeah.
And if you're encouraged, just type amen.
Yes.
So if you are in fear, I hope that's not what's coming out of your heart or what you are getting from this.
Uh-huh.
Amen. So.
And maybe, well, if you are fearful.
And the question is why?
Yes, the question is why. I think the only reason why we would be fearful about Jesus' return is that if we are not under His Lordship.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Let's read this from Joshua.
Mm-hmm.
And our hope is not wishful thought, but the confident, expectant, joyful knowledge. The appearing of the glory of the great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, Titus 2:13. Amen.
Yes, that's right.
Amen.
Love it.
Wow.
I love it. Okay, great. So now we are, thank you for the amens that people are typing in right now. We see that you're still here.
Amen.
And you're still tuned in.
Not only amen from JC, but some fire in there.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.